Hello, everyone, and welcome to the latest webinar from Medicus. We are very excited to have you join us today. Thank you for being okay with the rescheduling if you were originally scheduled for last week, but we have a great webinar planned for you today. I will give a few moments for everyone to get on and get comfortable, but you are joining the Medicus webinar titled The Great Retention, How IT Transformation Impacts Top Talent and Patient Experience. Isn't it so nice to hear the great retention instead of the great resignation? We like it too. So while you guys are joining, I will set a few reminders. This is being recorded, as you probably heard when you came on. So if you want to re-listen to anything or share it with any colleagues after the fact, you are welcome to. We'll be sending out the recording this weekend. We also will have time at the end for open question and answer because this is live. This is real. So you can have questions for any of our speakers. Feel free to post them in the Q&A feature on Zoom whenever you're ready, or you can wait until the end, whatever your preference is. And we also will have a small poll before we get started, just so we can make sure we know who we're speaking with and cater the content to best suit your needs. So again, you're joining the Great Retention, and we will just wait 30 more seconds, and then we will get going. We have three amazing speakers with us today. We're going to share a lot of really useful information and then have time for question and answers. So I am excited. I think this is going to be a really useful conversation for many of you to be a part of. So let's get started. Welcome everyone to the latest webinar with Medicus. We are here for The Great Retention, How IT Transformation Impacts Top Talent and Patient Experience. So what is this webinar all about today? Well, as we continue to endure the Great Resignation, which is probably what most of you have heard of, the mass exodus of employees leaving their jobs in search of something better, the work landscape has been forever changed. And what used to be the status quo is no longer good enough. Employees all over are demanding more flexibility and more pay. Work-life balance and mental health have become more realistic indicators of career success. And it's very critical that organizations like yours, especially those of us in healthcare, are proactive in retaining their employees before they think of leaving. So with digital transformation revolutionizing how we work and communicate, it shouldn't be a surprise that one of the keys to remaining top talent lies in technology. So today we are going to speak about that with our three industry experts to learn how leveraging technology can positively impact your patient experience and enable your healthcare organization to take strategic targeted actions towards retaining exceptional staff. So our speakers, we have three amazing speakers today. First, we have Dr. Ertha Nanton. Dr. Nanton is the Chief Medical Officer of Clinical Operations at Nevada Health Centers. She's a certified physician executive and she's practiced medicine for over 25 years. Her medical career has taken her to the Bahamas and England before moving to the US to pursue a residency. She has garnered vast clinical experience in an outpatient, inpatient, urgent care, ER, and residential care setting. After building her practice in Canada, she was given the opportunity to be the regional medical director at Nevada Health Centers. And today, she became the chief medical officer, or not today, but as of today, she became the chief medical officer at Nevada Health Centers and has played an instrumental role in managing providers throughout the COVID era. So she's going to be great insight from the physician and practitioner standpoint. Our next speaker is Manuel Pedroza. Manuel, we are really excited to have him today. He's the Chief Information Officer at Clinica Sierra Vista. So he's going to come from the technology side from a big healthcare group. So he's served as a healthcare industry executive for nonprofit organizations for many years now. He provides leadership for continued development of innovative, robust, and secure IT environments. And today's Clinica Sierra Vista services more than 200 providers, 1,500 employees, 50 locations, and nearly 150,000 patient lives and 500,000 visits each year. So after spending nearly a decade in IT, where he's done a lot of consulting and implementing innovative services, he is able to bring that through into the healthcare organization. And last, but very much not least, we have our very own Tim Hebert. He is our Chief Revenue Officer here at Medicus IT. As a perennial entrepreneur, innovator, and adventurer, Tim has been a business owner for well over two decades. Before joining us at Medicus, he ran an IT service firm called Atrion, which was a 160 million, 260 plus employee organization. He also founded Trillix, a consulting and application development firm, and he has been a chief managed service officer for Carousel Industries. If you recognize his name, it might be because he has a great book out on the shelves and on Amazon called The Intentional Leader, and he speaks on this topic worldwide and on many media outlets. So you can see we have a really great different kinds of experience coming together for our panelists. So before we actually get into it, I am going to launch a quick poll. I hope those of you that can see it can answer a few quick questions to help us make sure that we tailor this content to serve your needs and why you are here today. So the question should be on your screen. This is anonymous, so you can be honest. Has your organization been affected by the Great Resignation? Yes, no, or not sure. How much of your time is spent on talent, attracting, selecting, hiring, retaining, anything regarding your talent? Number three, how important is culture to retaining employees in your organization? And then a couple questions just to help us. How did you find out about this webinar? You can click more than one if you've attended a previous webinar and maybe you heard about this one again on LinkedIn. And of course, what is your occupation? So thank you for answering these questions. I will just give a couple more seconds here while I remind everyone that we will have time at the end for question and answer. So you can feel free to use the Q&A feature in Zoom to post your questions whenever you have them. And otherwise, you can wait till the end and we're going to get to as many as possible. So last chance to get these poll questions in. And then we are going to hand it over to Tim. All right. Oh, you can still come in. All right. Five more seconds. Five, four, three, two, and one. Thank you all so much for participating. And Tim, I will share the results so you can see them.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Rissa, I wish I could bottle up your energy. We wouldn't have an energy crisis. We wouldn't have gas prices through the roof. We could just, you know, bottle that up and start selling it. So thank you for the great introduction and kicking off this meeting. I'd like to welcome my guests, Ertha and Manuel, to the conversation. We spent a number of hours preparing for this, and I'm really excited about this topic. I think it's timely. I think that our organizations are facing an inflection point, a transition moment that we've never seen in the history of our businesses and organizations. So it's really how we start to think about this is really important. What I want to do is I want to start, before we jump into the meat of the dialogue, what I want to do is I want to take a few seconds and just kind of define what I think the problem is that we're seeing out there that many of our organizations are seeing and experiencing. So we talk about this thing called the Great Resignation. And what I'm sharing here is a slide that compares 2 years together. It shows the year 2020, which is it's kind of a down year. COVID hit. You can see how, you know, kind of numbers changed drastically in around the April timeframe of 2020 when COVID really kind of took its first bite out of us. Then we can look at what happened in 2021, and we can see the amount of resignations have increased to be an all-time high. So what happened last year, when we think of last year, roughly about 47.8 million, almost 48 million people resigned from their positions and they left the workplace. We're on pace to reach that number and potentially exceed that number in 2022. Matter of fact, I think last month was the highest number of resignations that have occurred since this has begun. And you can see over the course of the last year that we're averaging about 4 million plus people resigning from the workplace on an average basis. So this means that most of our organizations through the last couple of years, have been running understaffed and trying to do the same amount of work, meeting the same number of patients, doing the same activities with less people to do this. And if we are also consuming energies and cycles trying to retain and attract new talent and bring them in, so we're constantly interviewing, selecting new people, bringing them in, as soon as we get to a point where our staffing levels are whole again, we end up losing someone else and we'll go through the process over and over again. So we're in this mode of constant recruitment that we've never really faced in the same way in the past. And that's just to keep treading water. It doesn't affect, it doesn't impact the way we have to grow our organizations, adding people to grow our what we're putting in place. The second thing I thought was really interesting, the research we saw as I was preparing for this that I thought was interesting, were the reasons why people are leaving. So you can see the chart on the left-hand side of the screen here where we talk about low pay. And low pay is kind of a misnomer. I think what's happened in the last few years with COVID and the way things have happened is that people are a lot more sensitive to compensation as the overall driver for whether they're happy and content with their positions. And as unemployment has actually gone to a point where it's an all-time low, or at least a 50-year low, what we're seeing is there's more opportunities to increase compensation. So people are leaving for more money. We see it happening every day. We also see people feel that they've hit that ceiling. They're doing the same job over and over. There's no room for advancement. There's no development being put into them. Employees are feeling disrespected. So we can go through all these different environments, but I kind of walked away from this with what I thought were the four main things that really people are looking for: new opportunities. They want to make more money. They want to do new and exciting things. They want to expand their professional careers and take on new challenges. So opportunity is a big driving factor that we're seeing in this current wave. The second thing that we've seen, and I think in the last 2 to 3 years, we've really seen this, there's been a high degree of burnout. As we do more work with less people, we have to invest more of our energy into getting the job done. So there's a burnout factor there. I will say COVID had a huge impact, especially in the healthcare industry. Coming in every day and you're being exposed to patients that have COVID and being in that environment, the threat and the concern for your family, the worry that that brings, added to the stress of just trying to get the job done, having to change and redesign every workflow that we have to be able to work in a COVID environment, really kind of put a lot of stress on organizations, and people started questioning whether it was worth it for them. And many chose to opt out of the workplace or change because of that stress. Another interesting thing that happened is I sat down in the beginning of 2020, and I worked with a very large company, 14,000 employees, and I was helping them put together a work from home remote employee strategy. And this company was being very cautious about how they wanted to roll this out. Now, this is in December 2019, January of 2020. So we sat down and I was talking to them about this concept that we need to think more holistically, that virtual work from home, the gig economy, those kind of things were going to be realities that we're faced with. But they wanted to take a slow and cautious approach to this. So they identified 200 out of 14,000 people that would be designed from their base that would work from home. They redesigned and rewrote all their policies. They launched their policies at the end of February. Between then and the end of April, they rewrote the policy 4 times and relaunched their policy. It went from 200 people to essentially the entire organization that was working from home in less than 60 days. So what happened was our employee base, faster than we anticipated, was moved into a remote work from home environment. And once we opened up that bottle, it's like opening up the genie lamp. The genie is out now. We can't go back and we can't change it. There are people that leave because they're leaving their jobs as they're being asked to come back into the workplace 3, 4, even 5 days a week. They're deciding that they want to work from home, and there's organizations that will allow that. So being able to work in this remote work from home environment has been really helpful. We've seen people in my own company and some of our clients who are working for that may be located in a geography, say like downtown Boston, that's where they live, where that's where they work. They've decided to move to the country. Now they're living in Maine, doing the work from Maine versus in the Boston area. So it's changed the way we work in general. In the last area that we've seen, I think in the last 2 to 3 years, COVID has forced us, and not just COVID, but COVID's probably the main driver, has forced us to reevaluate what's important in our lives. And I think some people have reprioritized work as a lower priority, and they're putting more emphasis on family, connection, being more accessible, being more present in those environments, and they're de-emphasizing work and they're consequently looking for jobs that promote that. So these are some of the reasons that we've seen people kind of resign from the organization. Now, what I want to do on this call, I want to do something a little bit different. I don't want to explore this any more than we've talked about today. But what I want to do is I want to shift the focus from the problem of resignation. I think there's a huge opportunity for us as business leaders to change the complexion of the way the workforce goes for the next 5 to 10 years. And what I want to do is I want to shift the conversation. What I think is the biggest opportunity for us is to focus on retention. How do we retain that talent that we bring to our organization that's essential to move us forward, will help us grow the organizations, help us serve our patients, and help us deliver the outcomes that we desire. And then as we are attracting new employees, we're retaining them for a longer period of time. So I'm referring to this as the great retention. So that's where I want to start the conversation. So I have Ertha and Manuel that will have that will be part of our conversation today. So what I'd like to do is just start by getting a little bit of a background on each of our guest speakers today. So Ertha, could you kind of, give us a little oversight of your organization and what you do for that organization? Let's use that as a starting point.
Thank you, Manuel. Thank you, Tim. Thanks for having me here today. I appreciate the opportunity to share with the organization that I work with. As the chief medical officer, I work at Nevada Health Centers in that role, and we are a federally qualified health center here in Nevada. We provide a service to about 40 to 45,000 lives every year. And it's interesting that COVID did not pass us, as you well know. Mm-hmm. We have been the center of COVID. And two things that we felt helped us is that we had already telehealth as one of our mainstay before COVID became an issue. And we also had people who we felt were already family for the organization. So I think as we talk a little bit more, we'll see how these two things impacted how we moved through this process during COVID.
Awesome, I appreciate that. Manuel, how about yourself? A little bit about your organization, yourself, and the role you play.
Yeah, so thanks, Tim. Very similar to Dr. Nanton mentioned, we're a federally qualified health center and pretty much right in the smack in the middle of Central California. We cover kind of a high level migrant seasonal population, and in our more urban areas, homeless. It's potentially the foothold of what we do, providing care to the underserved communities of Central California. But we're a 50-year-old organization. We've been around since the early 70s. We've gone through a tremendous amount of change, I feel like, in at least the last 5 years. I've been here for a year and a half, but I'm well aware of the work that's occurred before me being here. One of the kind of the common themes here is we're kind of reshaping and rethinking a lot of what we do. And it's kind of iterative, constant change for us, which we all know change in healthcare isn't really change anymore. It's just a constant these days. But we can talk a little bit about that as we progress through the session and how we're moving forward.
Awesome. So our focus, our Evolve series that we've been running since January, we spent a lot of time talking about technology, and we've spent a lot of time talking about transformation. And the kind of the set the stage for the conversation is we look at the activities we do as a business into three buckets, essentially. This is oversimplification, but there's part of the activities that we do that just focus on runs, the things we have to do to keep the lights on, to keep the business going. And what I find in most organizations, most of our time, energy, and money goes into that bucket. Depending on the maturity of the organization, that can be anywhere from 65 to 90, 95% of their energy goes in just keeping the lights on, going through the motions. We then talk about the second bucket is a growth bucket. This is where organizations face on expanding their footprint, expanding their reach, expanding their capabilities and what they do. In many cases, in what we're talking about here is maybe looking at how we're expanding to serve our population better, either bringing in more kind of care for our population or reaching out to a wider band of the population. And we find good organizations are able to spend 10 to 20% of their time in this growth activity. and it's time, energy, and money that they put in there. Then the last bucket, which I think is the most important bucket that we need to look at, is what we call transformation. This is changing the way we do business. This is to be able to scale, to be able to reach people. It sounds like, Ertha, in your environment, you guys had embraced the telehealth thing before a lot of organizations did, to a larger scale than many organizations. And then when COVID reared its ugly head, you were able to rapidly respond and shift your business model almost overnight without having to retool things. So that to me is a transformational element that exists within your organization. So I want to focus on that bucket the most, because that's where I think the biggest bang for us to kind of make a change and have an impact is there. So first of all, in your organizations, and Manuel, I'll start with you on this one. How are you looking at transformation as an organization? Is it a big part of your conversation? Is it something that you're trying to drive personally as the CIO of the organization?
Yeah, I like to believe so, Tim. I think, the way that you define those three buckets, I think it will work a lot of the same way personally. I know that again, based on the technical maturity, where you are as an organization using digital tools, things like that, determine where IT fits into the puzzle at that point in time. And for us, very much right now, it's more about a lot of the KTLO, or keep the lights on, right? Yeah. And so what I mean by that is frictionless experiences, trying to reduce technical debt, and really focusing on consistent, repeatable approaches to the tech that we deliver. Before we want to get to that innovative business aligned, technology department, we have to make sure that we're delivering on the foundation, right? We can't build upon an environment that's constantly changing or that's not stable for the business in the context of the business. So for us, very much so, very closely aligned, 60% of that work today is very much on making sure that IT is focused on foundational security, confidentiality, integrity of our systems before we move on to what we call, the sexy side of IT, right? But it's very much a journey. Not to say we're not doing that. In the absence of those three buckets, right, IT always has to be focused on any one of those levers, those three levers, if you would. And if we pull the gas off of one of them, we fail as an organization. So that's kind of our view on it right now.
Yeah, and it's about
just shifting. I just want to jump in here right away and say, I want to follow up on what Manuel was saying. The way in which I see it too is that we shifted over the decades, mm-hmm. where in healthcare, the physician was the center of the universe. Mm-hmm. And what the physician said was based on what the physician was taught. And then as time has gone on, we moved from that, we moved into more of a business model where the business became, the major component. And now what I feel is that everything should be answerable to IT. IT is now the center of the universe. And from our quality to our finance, to our population management, to any type of data collection, everything actually resolves around it. And I feel that one of those things that we need to be actually looking at is how we shift and realize that this is now our center and how it impacts every other aspect of our health lives. That to me is where we need to be moving to, because even as you speak of growth, in business, we thought about increasing more buildings. We thought about increasing, more structure. But as we are looking now at the new world that we're living in, maybe we have to be considering shrinking those, becoming cognizant that you have people who are at home and they want to work from home, and therefore we don't need to have them coming into offices anymore. We can get the same bang for our buck if they were to work from home and not be in an office at this time. So all of that helps with reducing cost. And it also helps with, employee satisfaction. So I think those are some of the areas in which, as we talk again about IT and where we're going with it, those are the things I feel we need to concentrate on.
Well, I think it's interesting that a chief medical officer says that technology is the center of healthcare going forward. But I think the issue with it, what you're getting to, right, is that technology has the ability to be transformational, right? It changes the way we do things. And if we focus on using the technology in the right way, we can create things that allow us to move faster, treat more patients. And one of the things I think that I heard you say, and I think that we had to experience this a little bit in the COVID years, is that for the longest time, healthcare has become this thing where everyone comes to one centralized location, right? So it's this centralization. In the IT world, Manuel, you've been around, for not quite as long as I have been, but you remember the days of the mainframes where everyone came to one computing platform. What I see happening is there's now a distribution of that, right? It's being distributed as opposed to being centralized. And the ultimate goal of that is our employees and our patients don't have to come into a facility for some of the services that we need to deliver, or some of the work we need to do. So only way to be able to bridge that gap is through technology. And I think what we saw when we talked in our preparation sessions for this, I think in both organizations, you guys saw that you were able to shift pretty quickly to have people work remotely and to serve patients remotely as this happened, because you had done the right things in preparing for a more agile technology platform to run. Is that true, or did I miss something there?
I would say that's true. I think, as an FQHC organization, nonprofit, safety net healthcare centers like ours, we have to be able to adapt very quickly to the needs of the organization and to the needs of our community and our patients. So yes, we went, we went all in on remote work early on in some areas of the business that made more sense than others. Now it's more about kind of reverse engineering that. Now we've had time to, we've had a couple of years of that. How do we make more frictionless experiences for our employees? How do we enable hybrid work? How do we make digital native, if you would, make sense for our organizations?
Yeah, and also too, you've experienced one of our last sessions we did, we talked about the fact that we now distribute the workforce also increases our risk. So it's also managing risk and compliance at a different level too, right? So as we go forward into that, how about on your side, were you able to make and navigate? You said it sounds like on the patient side that you were good to do that. How did it work on the employee side? Ertha.
Oh, sorry, I didn't realize that question was for me. Could you just ask the question again?
Yeah, so I was saying that on your side, I know that you mentioned that you did the telehealth early on, you're able to make the migration, and that really helped you out during the COVID years. How were you prepared and able to transition when your employees became having to work remotely?
It's quite interesting that we couldn't get all of our employees to work remotely, but we were able to identify, for example, our call center. Many of them were working within an office setting, and we realized as, COVID progressed, there was no need for many of them to be in the office. So we were able to, assign them at home. There was also some other, areas, ancillary services that we were able to actually just, have them work from home. We found that, providing them with the technology from home became one of those things that we had to address. It even went as far as whether or not they got things like ergonomic, seats and computers and various things like that. I think that as time has gone on, we've had to rethink as a company how we are going to move forward in the future, and whether or not, as I said, even in terms of growth, do we grow, exponentially by having more buildings, or whether or not we grow by having more people within their own buildings? And that is something that we've been still struggling with. We know that for providers, many of them who do telehealth, and we do have a number of them, there are pros and cons to that, in that, yes, you get to still meet with your patients, and COVID helped with at least improving that aspect of it. We would have more access. But then at the same time, you don't have the ability to actually have contact with your patients. But more and more, we're seeing that this, as we progress in the decades to come, we are being exposed to more infectious type diseases. COVID is just one of them. Now we have monkeypox, which is another one. And with that, many of us may not be able to practice the way we would like to, where we are able to examine our patients. Some of us may have to do this from a distance. And I feel that that's, again, having the technology already available to provide that type of meeting with patients is very important.
You know, I think you guys brought up a good point too, right? So there's a couple of things that are happening here. You know, number one is that there is a desire with some of the workforce to work remote. You know, that's been, you know, especially in areas that have long commutes, difficult traffic modes, you know, things like that. So the remote working, it makes a lot of sense for some employees. If you're like me, I love being in the office, love being around a lot of people, but in some cases, it's not our choice. We're not making the decision whether or not we can be in that environment. Something greater than us is saying, you can't do this because of, you know, COVID, monkeypox, whatever. By the way, I thought monkeypox was a joke when I first heard this. It's like, what's now? We're gonna have locusts, you know, falling from the sky, but yeah. But the idea behind this is that, you know, we have to be able to respond and react. And I think where I heard you say, Ertha, that I think is important, and Manuel, we talked about this, I think the last time we talked, is that we have to design our organizations for the future, right? We have to get them stable for it supports what we're doing today, but we have to be thinking about what's going to look like 5 years, 10 years from now. We know infectious diseases are an increase. We know that's going to be a reality that we're going to be faced with. This wasn't a once in a century kind of thing to happen. We're going to face this more and more and more. We're a global world, and these diseases are spreading faster and faster, no matter with what precautions we have. We have to be able to respond. The desires of our workforce are going to change, right? And they're going to want to have different things that we need to provide from a technology perspective. So if we want to retain the best talent, we have to be able to meet them where they're at versus where we want them to be at. So I think that's a big reality that we have to face as we go forward with this. You know, so when we talk about technology and we talk about how it's actually changing the nature of our business, one of the conversations that we had with both is that it's not just about making it so someone can work from home, but it's also how do we use technology to change the process, the workflow, the actual work being done. And Ertha, I'm going to go back to you for a second on this. You kind of shared with me an experience where you were looking at specific parts of your business that you could kind of bring automation to play and better workflow management. And can you kind of, you know, share that story with us and kind of what you're thinking about that?
Absolutely, sure. One of our areas where we, you know, struggle a little bit is when it comes to referrals. We are an FQHC, and here in Nevada, there are a number of our patients who are uninsured. It's very, very tough to get them in to see specialists. And the process that we actually have is one where, you know, the providers send the referrals to the department, and then that department then takes it and then try to make these appointments for patients. We do have some technology that we use at this time, but it doesn't seem to be all cohesive. It's quite disjointed where, you know, we have our own EMR where the referral team is actually looking at trying to link that with another electronic system that tries to give them information with respect to the specialist, and then still having to make phone calls with that, again, to contact the specialist. So it takes up a huge amount of time when it comes to trying to link all these things and then get back to the patient as well. So I feel that there's some way in which we can actually, you know, if technology can be able to link some of these things, would be quite helpful in getting our patients through the system, because the patients will be satisfied because they are getting their referrals in a timely fashion.
Yeah. And it seems to me like from an employee perspective, this is about retention, right? I would imagine the way it's working now is a lot of manual work that our employees are doing. It's a lot of tedious work that's being done. And I think it, from my perspective, it's work that moves them away from the actual patient experience, right? So they're not really focused on the patient experience and meaning and that. So it moves them further away from the mission and what we're trying to do. So they're not as connected to what we're trying to do. They're doing a job. They're moving the paper. They're moving the button. So what happens if we use technology right, we can streamline that process, make it more efficient so our patients have a better experience. But more importantly, that the people that are driving these processes can do more. They can feel more productive, less burnout, less frustration with the systems when they're not working. And we can then start pulling in and connecting them to how they actually have an impact on patient outcomes and patient experience. And Manny, Manuel, do you agree with that? Is that something that you're seeing as well in your organization, looking at those kind of things?
Yeah, absolutely. I would probably attest that anybody who's in an FQHC doesn't have challenges with referrals. You know, you're kind of a diamond in the rough. Specifically, you know, we're talking about a population, highly Medicaid population, that very limited in terms of the specialties that we're able to connect them to care with. and things to that. So it becomes a payer-driven, a market-driven conversation very quickly about the challenges that we have to succumb to. But beyond that, I think I agree with Dr. Nanton's sentiment around, you know, technology essentially being the hub. I think we talked to that a little bit, but tech is kind of uniquely positioned in healthcare to be able to see the challenges that exist in all the business units, being that, you know, everyone is so reliant either on data or technology tools to do their work these days. So I'd like to think that we're probably the most you know, significant business unit that has the opportunity to get the 30,000 foot view across the organization and see what the challenges of clinical care are, what the challenges are with the patient population health, what the challenges are with finance and ongoing, you know, all of the other business units. So absolutely agree with the sentiment. I think that, you know, we need to think about technology in a little bit different way. The other piece of that is that cloud has really given us, you know, the promise of the cloud, if you will, has given us a unique way to approach technology. You know, it's more about, again, creating more seamless experiences for our employees, whether they work from home or work in the office. We want that to be provided in a consistent, secure manner, right? And so that's, I very much agree with that.
You know, it's kind of funny. I remember back an early conversation with a very large company, you know, manufacturer, you know, back in the early 90s with the internet, before the internet came out. I remember doing a presentation with them talking about the internet, how it's going to be everywhere, and it's going to be how business is being done. And I remember being at the end of the meeting, you know, people talked to me and they said, we're never going to ever connect to the internet. It's too insecure. We're not going to do X, Y, Z. You know, now you can't survive if you're not connected to the internet. The internet drives your business. I think cloud has that same capacity, right, to change our business in the same way. A lot of businesses have been slow to adopt this, but companies that had a stronger cloud platform before COVID were able to make the transition to respond to COVID at a much faster rate than those that didn't. The ones that were still with a lot of on-prem stuff had a lot of issues they had to fix before they could actually really fully embrace what had to be done to survive during the COVID era. And quite frankly, some businesses that I know of didn't survive that transition. They couldn't react and respond fast enough, and they became a casualty of that process. So being able to use those technologies in that fashion is really important. I want to shift the gears a little bit here because, you know, I'm a technologist, I'm in the technology industry, but I think the technology side, being able to bring automation and efficiency and, you know, bring using technology to bring us closer to our patients when they're further away from us, right? All those things that technology can do is only one half the equation. I think the other half of the equation, and I kind of talk about, it's about leadership, right? It's about how do we actually change the way we think about this. What I love about this conversation with my panelists today is that we have someone that's on the IT side. They eat, you know, IT every morning. They get up, it's like a box of Wheaties. They pour their IT in a bowl and they eat it with a little bit of milk and stuff, but they live IT every day. And then we have someone on the other side that's the chief medical officer that's focused on delivering patient care, right? And delivering the services. And the fact that we've come together to realize that those conversations have to be different, right? If we're going to really succeed, we can't be siloed anymore. We have to be able to work across those silos. To me, one of the things that was very apparent when we were preparing for this is that the type of talent that we look for is going to be different going forward. We can't look at people that are just IT technical people that don't have strong communication skills. So let's start on that a little bit and kind of talk about what we see shifting in how we want to bring in talent to the organization that are maybe a better fit for the organization for a long term. So Manny, let me start with you, then we'll have Ertha jump in a second. So what are some of the things that you're seeing or doing on that end around talent and getting the right people in the organization?
Yeah, I think, you know, as we touched on previously, it's more about the passion that connects people to work. I thought a lot about what it means to be a leader, and I think I've kind of kept some things that have been mentioned to me in the past. You know, of course, being a leader is less about managing folks and more about leading a conversation to change hearts and minds rather than, you know, than anything else. I find that the value in leadership is more about the conversation that you're willing to have with the people doing the work and guiding them through the journey that is change. So I know we talk about change management as if it's this monolithic thing that exists, you know, at the organization strategy level, but it's really more about making sure the people are equipped to handle that change and making sure they understand the benefits and why it is that we're doing what we're doing. So I think collaboration, teamwork, and ultimately the open lines of communication are really what I found great success in. But what I look for often is more so fit with culture. The technical can be learned, right? We all know that. I think in technology, we're always learning, and as well as other industry. But, you know, you hire for people with a passion to do better or to drive an organization forward or that have that sense of community camaraderie in an organization. So that's what we look for.
Yeah, I love that. So what I love about the comment, Manuel, is that it's just a focused kind of your journey too, right? For you to be successful going forward, it's less about managing people, but it's leading people. So there's new skills that you're learning every day to put them into the motion to be able to lead teams going forward. And I think the comment about change being a continuous aspect is really important. Ertha, what would you add to this? Because I know we had some conversation, I'm sure, on the whole organization is delivering healthcare. There's changes occurring across the board as well.
Yes, I couldn't agree with Manuel more. What I've found is that when I'm interviewing for, you know, positions at an organization, I look for two things. One, is this person a self-starter? And two, whether or not they're a team player. I think it fits right back into, you know, hiring the best fit. We can all have the same qualifications, but how do you distinguish whether or not this person can act as a team and work within the culture of your organization? Because many of the issues that we face over time doesn't come necessarily with the skill sets, but with the interaction with each other. And I think as we move forward, we become better at trying to pick those type of team members out and develop that talent. Because we can teach, as Manuel's point, you can teach some of these things. You can teach the technology. I can teach medicine. But you can't really teach someone who may you want to stay in the organization and they are, you know, not really wanting to be there, or this was not really their true calling. Mm-hmm. We want to be able to develop the type of people who want to not only just have talent, but also wanting to contribute what they have to the organization.
You know, it's interesting. I like that portion. And I'm gonna pull out kind of a couple of words that you've mentioned on both sides. Is this word about purpose, meaning, calling, right? I think when we talk about how do we get people to retain, to stay in a company longer, how do we increase the retention of that employee? We got to make it someplace that they want to be because there's something greater than just a paycheck that's keeping them here, right? So when I look at employees and the way we think, employees can think at three different levels. They can think that I have a job, and a job is I do an hour's worth of work and I get an hour's worth of pay. And there's no discretion there. And it's very black and white. And consequently, we treat those employees in a black and white environment, right? We don't give them the same leeway that we give people that may put more discretionary effort into what we do. And it's more about compliance too. We make them comply, fill out your time card, do this, do that, right? There's a lot of compliance elements that we build into that. The next level up, I think that some employees do, they're looking for a career. They want to build a career for themselves. So it's how do I advance through the ranks? How do I learn more information? How do I become more relevant? How do I have a bigger impact in the organization? And it's about me and developing myself and moving myself forward through the organization. And that's part of that self-starter. People that have that initiative inside them, they constantly want to be moving through. They want to do more. They want to take on more. They like challenges. They like change because it creates opportunity for them to grow. And those individuals are there for more than just a paycheck, right? For them, it's about their personal attainment, what they can achieve in life, right? Then the third one, which I think is important, we can navigate and help employees move through this continuum from a job to a career by the efforts that we put into them. In our organizations, we hire people that are more aligned to being able to move through that path. But the highest level is what I call a there for something more than a paycheck. There because the cause, the mission, the meaning of the organization is really driving us forward. So for me, that's kind of how I look at it. So building purpose within individuals. And what I'm finding is the younger generation coming to the workforce, they're looking more to have an impact. So purpose and meaning is something that they're looking for in work. And when they don't see it, then it just becomes a job. And many of them aren't really interested in the job. Are you guys seeing the same thing as you're going through And is it changing at all?
Yes, you know, I've spoken with, you know, millennials and Gen Zs, and even though sometimes we think that they're just, you know, technology driven, I think many of them grew up with, you know, the baby boomers looking at the Gen Xs and saying, I don't want my life to be like yours, where you just go to work and then your life ends up, you know, sideways for some reason. So they're coming in with a different purpose, and they want to make sure that what they're doing is contributing to something. And I feel that that's where we can capture them, and we can actually, you know, mold them the way in which we want to, because there's also that other element of whether or not we think that they are as productive as we would like them to be. Because I'm from the older generation where I think that, you know, to be productive, you have to really work very hard. But for them, I think it's just about, it must be purposeful work. And therefore, I will work toward that purpose. It shouldn't be just work. And with that, it shifts a little bit. It shifts the ground under you if you're an older generation not realizing that, that they can still produce as much as you would want them to produce, even if you think that, you know what, it's not a five-day week and it's probably a three-day week. Even if you think that the hours that you want to offer them is less than what you would otherwise work, they are more productive and they have more purpose. And I think that's the kind of force that we're going to be looking at in the future and should be looking at even now.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I know that when we talked during the practice session, we talked about kind of looking for that people that are naturally aligned for that purpose, that calling and meeting. But as leaders, and I'll go to what Manuel said, is that we as leaders have to be able to inspire that in our team, right? Inspire them and get them to see the meaning and purpose in the job. And so I know, Manuel, in your team, now you lead a team of IT individuals that you're dealing with on a day-to-day basis. How are you addressing, because IT can be quite boring, right? You're not delivering patient care, you're not doing surgeries, you know, and quite frankly, you know, we acknowledged already that IT is not sexy, or a lot of aspects of IT are not sexy. How do you actually build meaning? What do you do to build meaning and purpose with the current workforce plus the younger generation is coming in?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, as technologists, I think we like to believe that everything that we do is the sexiest thing, right? And it's the best thing to be doing, right?
Yeah. But I think you geeked out about things, that's for sure.
it's more about, you know, the why are we doing this now? What does this mean to the organization? What does this mean in our journey to getting there? And really what I like to talk more about is the promise of technology, right? And what it delivers. Should we accomplish what we need to accomplish today? What does that mean to tomorrow, right? And really what I find the most intriguing about healthcare is that it's largely driven by data and analytics and the promise of data driving kind of new ways of delivering care in more efficient and effective ways in our organizations. You know, population health scratches the surface, but, you know, there's some really exciting work happening in other industries like pharma and you know, where they're looking and leveraging this technology to make decisions faster so that we can provide the best possible care. And that resonates with ambulatory care as well, like us. I mean, the promise that, you know, yes, we can manage 150,000 patients on a one-to-one basis when you're in front of me, but can I do that more effectively by building cohorts, populations, looking at their conditions and really looking at the data and leveraging that to provide care? That's what I find the most intriguing about technology in healthcare and where it takes us.
So you're finding a way to take the technology work that you do and connect it to the greater purpose of what your industry, your organization is trying to accomplish, and putting the employee in front and center of that. So you're helping them see that purpose and see that connection. I think it's a huge, to me, it makes a lot of sense to do that. And I think, you know, I think it can definitely change the way they feel about the organization themselves.
I just want to jump in here, Tim, and say that it has also provided actually increased patient access. We have not been able to see the number of patients that we were able to see if we didn't have the technology that we have. As we well know, many of our providers we spoke about earlier are burned out. Just like any other group that's been working quite hard during the COVID period and even before that, and being able to work the way they want to, the hours they would like to, has helped because they can now at least feel a little bit more recharged And the patient also has more access because now being at home, being in a different environment where they're comfortable, they're able to reach patients that otherwise we would not be able to reach. So technology has helped with that tremendously.
Yeah, absolutely. I can see how that makes a difference, right? And the way, not even just their well-being about being an employee, they're not getting as burned out as fast. They're able to get more accomplished, maybe in different, using their time in a slightly different way. They can integrate their personal life and their work life together a little bit more. So there's more balance, there's more connection there, which we saw some people reprioritizing, right? So it allows us to do those things that we couldn't have done beforehand. But it also allows me to reach people that are in need, right? That we wouldn't get to see otherwise and wouldn't be able to help. So I think that's been a huge impact. Mm-hmm. The one last thing I'll do before we kind of go to the wrap up is that the one thing that I think that I heard through there, if I pull it out a little bit, is that we have to invest in our employees in the organization. So there's a level of development that we have to train them, we have to educate them, we have to provide the connection between the work they do and the mission of what the organization is doing. And so just real quickly, you know, kind of a thought, Ertha, on kind of what you think about investing and developing your talent in that fashion. And is there anything you're doing that's helping with that process?
Yes, I can't agree with you more. I mean, we've approached it in two ways. The first way is that we internally decided to have our own university where we can improve training. We've used, you know, the typical training methods of RELIAS and continue to do so. But we have at least hired talent where we can have someone train the staff, not only just from the executive, but all the way through. And then the other aspect of retention, we realized that we had to actually make some moves in changing our MA model. Even at this point, we're looking at changing the front office model where we have more of a tiered system of approach. So people can actually work their way upward to other positions within the company. I feel that that's one of the ways in which you look at retention as well, how well you can keep those people by actually improving their ability to make steps upward and feel like they're being promoted to another position where they can get better compensation.
It's that career progression, right? So if it's only a job they come in and do and it's the same thing over and over for 5-10 years and there's no progression for them, they're going to view it as a job. Correct. If I can do them and see there's a career pathway, it's now I start looking at it as a career. If I tie mission and purpose in, it becomes more of a calling. I know, Manuel, there's some things that you guys are doing over there that's trying to bridge the gap. So it's just not online learning. It's, you know, kind of, you know, making it more experiential. Kind of, can you talk about that for a second?
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's always opportunities and much to the sentiment that Dr. Nanton said as well, you know, the organization holistically is focused on trying to create those pathways for things like those frontline positions, your MA1s, your 2s, things like that. In IT, we very much made it a point that this work is still happening today. You know, at least when I came into the organization, we were predominantly pretty flat of an organization in terms of movement, mobility within the IT team. Creating structures that, you know, offer that next tier or a clear pathway for your employees is kind of foundational to that work. And so we did a lot of work in that area early on. Beyond that, I find, you know, giving employees the opportunity to stretch beyond their skill set. Strengthen their skills, strengthen their technical knowledge. Looking at what I really like to tout a lot about is looking at the intersection of technology and the business. We can have great technologists, but if you're just great at technology and you can't engage with business, you can't have conversations to understand the pain points of what you're trying to deliver, then really we're kind of shooting ourselves in the foot. So I make it a point to really focus on, okay, what's the experience that this technology will have on the user? What's the impact of that? What is the value proposition for doing this today? That's how I like to lead any technical initiative. And there's also some, you know, there's some obvious ones, of course. You know, compensation has a lot to do with, you know, your employees, opportunity for education, certification, you know, professional skilling, things like that. We're building in some of those structures today, and it's exciting, especially being a nonprofit. You actually get more benefits than you think. So I'd encourage you all as leaders, if you are a nonprofit community health center, talk to your partners. There's opportunity there to benefit your employees and your workforce. So
it's awesome. Yeah, you definitely have to make an investment. Our employees are our greatest asset in the organization. We have to invest in them just like we would any of our tools and equipment that we put in place. So just kind of recapping here, I think we've all experienced in the last 2 years, 2.5, 3 years, this great resignation. We've all felt the pain of it. When we saw the survey, most people are experiencing it at some level of degree, and they're spending a majority of their time kind of trying to deal with the consequences of the great resignation. I think the thing that I've taken away from this personally is that it's not going to go away. This is not a blip. This is not something that's happening today. We're facing the way, and like I said in the beginning, this is an inflection point. We're facing the way we need to look at employees and how we bring them to the organization to make them effective. We have to reinvent that. And I think we need to look at how do we retain more and how do we actually create culture, create that familyness, create that connectedness. We need to be able to bring leadership into the equation and really connect them to the purpose and meaning of what we're doing in a big way. So with that said, I'd like to kind of turn the reins back over to Rissa so she can actually take us home. So Rissa?
Thank you so much. That was an amazing conversation. Thank you so much. We have some great questions here and a recap to go through. Just before we get into the questions, I just want to make sure that everyone is aware and can mark their calendars for our next webinar topic so we can just continue this momentum. So mark your calendars, get out a pen. We have September 22nd at 12:30 Eastern time. September 22nd, and the topic is going to be Seeing Through the Clouds, How Not to Miss the Next Technology Migration.
I'll just add, this goes back to a comment that Manuel said, right? The importance of cloud and the futures of what we're trying to do for both retention of the team members, but also transformation of organizations. So,
absolutely. All right, well, let's get through to the first question. So this one's from Dan. So he says, very interesting conversation about staff working from home. Same roles are obvious, such as IT. Some roles are obvious, such as IT. But how have the panelists allowed schedulers, nurses, MAs, and billers to work from home? What infrastructure did you need to add? Was it a new phone system? Are staff members working partly in the office, partly at home, or are certain members 100% from home while others are 100% in the office? I'm trying to figure out the fairness model and how are you ensuring productivity in these roles? So a lot of questions in one, but a great.
Yeah, that could be a whole webinar in itself. So Ertha, would you like to kind of maybe start with this?
Yeah, I'll probably take a stab at it. Don't know if I'll be able to answer all the questions. One of the things, of course, is that we first had to determine who can work from home. Mm-hmm. Not everyone, as we know, MAs couldn't, physicians, for the most part, who were still working within the clinics, couldn't. But we did leverage our telehealth department, and they continued to work from home. We had MAs, of course, who would work with them, who could do this virtually as well. We also had our call center and many of our ancillary services, people who worked with our mama van that we have, those who were working from our pharmacy and so forth. There's some of them who could have done some of that work from home and didn't necessarily have to be in the office. So it's sitting with your team and trying to figure out exactly who are these people that you'll be able to work from home. Now, with respect to the accountability aspect of it, it's tough to say how you can account for everything that someone is doing. I think one of the things, even as we think about working from home, is that you have to understand that there's a satisfaction that you get if you are working from home and the ability for you to still take care of some of your personal things during that period of time. The question is, are you really interfering with the ability for the business to work? And I think even as we rethink this process, we have to look at it that way as well, because we're still human beings. I'm not going to sit in front of a computer for 8 hours and I'm at home because that's what my employer wants me to do. But I might sit in front of it for, you know, the 2 or 3 hours that I need to do good work. And at the same time, I can still use some of that time. Now, an employer may say this is not really the best thing that they want, and how do they keep people accountable? Well, you keep them accountable by making sure that they produce the things that you're asking them to produce in a timely fashion. And I feel that that's one of the ways in which you can do that. But trying to see if you can look to ensure whether or not they're actually doing work for the 8 hours that you're looking for, that might be a little bit more difficult to follow.
Yeah, Ertha, I think a couple of things I'll just add to this, and we'll have Manuel chime in here, is number one, I think that, you know, the the way we used to lead and manage people was we measured productivity and how much we're getting out of an employee by watching them sit in their seat. So we could walk over to the desk, we'd see, are they in their seats? They're in their seat. We assume they're working, then we assume they're being productive. What's happening is this is going to force us to really look at kind of understanding what are requirements of the job? What is the production we need? So instead of looking at and managing by are you in your seat, we look at the quality and the amount of work that you do in the time frame that you're given. What I've experienced is that, especially in early COVID with a lot of the accounts I either consulted with or I've been working with, is that we saw an increase in productivity. More work got done, whether it was a call center, they did more calls, or more, you know, work was getting done. And what we found, it wasn't being done in the standard 8 to 5 window that they typically worked in. People would get up early because they don't have a 2-hour commute. They're now working an hour earlier, right? They have no distractions. Yeah, they take an hour off to run to a doctor's appointment or take a kid to school, which is a quality of life. They come back, they're recharged, and they do more work. So we found a level of productivity increase during that process. And the last thing I would say is that, you know, a lot of organizations I've worked with, they basically create categories. There is a person that has to be 100% in the office. There's just certain roles that that's the only place it can exist. Then there's 100% of people that can, there's some percentage of that 100% of their work can be done remotely. They don't have to be in an office. What we're finding, the bulk of the work staff is in this hybrid mode where they're a little bit of both. They can do some work at home, they can do some work and they have to do some work in the office, and they're defining rules around this hybrid kind of engagement. And Manny, just kind of go to one of the things that you and I talked about is that one of the things that gets lost in the translation is that informal mentoring when it's all at home, right? So there's value in still being together and moving forward. So what would you add?
Yeah, I think if anything, I think really COVID just served really as a catalyst to surface a lot of organizational questions that we had historically that maybe went unanswered, right? So the question of how we measure a department's productivity, are they delivering on what they need to be delivering on for an organization, right? So very quickly for other departments, it became a value conversation. What's the value of them being here versus being remote, and determining, again, building that structure. These have to be 100%. We did a lot of piloting, of course, as many other organizations did. I think we even tried doing virtual check-in from, you know, whether it be through text messaging or through, you know, telehealth, serving as the mechanism for communicating with the receptionist, right? Those were all opportunities and pilots, but I think they've all driven kind of the thought process that is, you know, how are we going to approach this differently? Should we, you know, essentially encounter ourselves in this predicament again, even more so in the future? So that's just been some of the approach.
Yeah. One thing I'll add, go back to the technology part of the question. I think that there are, you know, I think Zoom and Teams and WebEx, those kind of technologies have really transformed the space. And it's, you cannot be an organization that does remote work and not have a significant investment, not only just in the tools, but to training how to properly use these tools in the most effective way. And those collaboration tools are really powerful in making this happen. And they do allow you to have this kind of conversation where we can see each other, we can talk. So you get the collaborative nature of this. You can also, you know, use these tools for accountability to some level. Another investment I think that really needs to be done is the way we use our telephony systems, our communication systems. We're no longer a phone system. It's really what I refer to as omni-channel communications. It's text messaging. It's you know, it's video. It's you know, the audio call that we have. Most of what I've seen in the healthcare industry today is still based on legacy type of telephony systems. They're not modern. They're not based on unified communication practices or voice over IP. There needs to be a way of looking at that. If I'm on cloud-based solutions using voice over IP, and this is a little technical, this conversation, what I can do and how I can actually meet my patients where they're at, meet my employees where they need to be, just changes the game. The people that had that were able to move faster than everyone else. And I think this is a central part of what we do. And the third thing I'll say, once again, these are generalities, and we'll talk a little bit more on the cloud one, is this, you know, being reticent to move to the cloud because of security and compliance. We have to get beyond that. Organizations that are in the cloud have a much superior ability to support a virtualized workforce and change the nature of how they do business. So from the technology side, those are the three things I look at: collaboration tools, unified communications, especially omnichannel communication platforms, and then the cloud-based solutions.
Well, you know, this is such a great conversation. I wish we could keep going, but I know a lot of our viewers that tuned in probably have other meetings right now. So look, let's continue this conversation. We're going to continue it. Make sure you're following us on LinkedIn. We'll send out emails and we will definitely get all the questions answered. I know there was a number we couldn't get to. And hey, maybe we need to do a part two, because this there's a lot more to say about these IT and technology solutions to allow this remote work model. So thank you so much, Manuel. Thank you, Dr. Nanton. Thank you, Tim, for sharing all your expertise from us. It's really great to hear your perspectives. Everyone, don't forget about the next webinar, Seeing Through the Clouds, September 22nd at 12:30 Eastern or 9:30 a.m. Pacific. And we look forward to seeing you guys on LinkedIn and email and at the next webinar. Please reach out if there's anything else we can help with. And if not, thank you again for coming.
Awesome.